In this video, I'll show you how to integrate your web application with Slack. We will create a Slack app and implement functionality that allows a web user to install this Slack app into his workspace. With the OAuth approach, we will get some permissions from a user for this app. At the end, we will receive and store an access token that we can use to call the Slack web API and interact with the user's workspace on behalf of the installed app. For implementation, I use TypeScript, Angular for the frontend, and Express.js for the backend. But the idea will be similar for other languages and frameworks. First, you need to go to api.slack.com and click on your apps to open the app dashboard. Then click the Create New Application button and select From Scratch. You need to enter the application name and select the development workspace. On the basic information page, you can find the client ID and secret key of the Slack app we just created. We need them for further integration. To make your application available not only in the development workspace, but also for all users, enable public distribution on the Manage Distribution page. Let's look at the big picture of integration with Slack. We have a web application and we want to be able to access to users' workspace in Slack from that application. For example, to send messages. For this purpose, we use Slack platform to create and distribute our own Slack application. This application will be added to the user's workspace with some permissions and will act as a kind of web application agent. So, the question is, how do you give the user the ability to install the Slack app in their workspace? To do this, we need to add a special Add to Slack button to the frontend interface of the web application. When the user clicks on this button, he will follow the installation link. This is what it looks like in my application. When the user clicks this button, they are taken to the app installation screen with a list of required permissions. After clicking the Allow button, the application will be added to the user's workspace with the specified permissions. If I go to the app drawer in my Slack workspace, I see Brain Assistant installed. The Slack website has kindly provided us with an install button generator that creates buttons based on the selected app, redirect paths, and scopes. Here is my Slack button component with generated code. The only thing that I've changed is the installation link, which I prefer to build and keep separately for clarity. The installation link consists of four paths. The first is the path to the Slack OAuth endpoint. It's constant. The second scopes are the permissions you want to ask the user for actions in their workspace. Here is my array of scopes, but it can be different depending on what API methods you are planning to use. You can find required scopes for every method in reference docs. The third part is the redirect URI. Once the user agrees to install the app with the requested permissions, they will be redirected to a special landing page with a temporary authorization code. You need to add the redirect path you plan to use in the redirect URL section of the OAuth and permissions page. The fourth and last part of the installation URI is a client ID. This is a unique public identifier for the Slack app, which you can find in the main app information. You can see that the Slack app installation process is based on the OAuth authorization flow. This is a common OAuth scheme. My application acts as a client of Slack authorization service. When a user clicks the Add to Slack button in the web app interface, they are taken to an OAuth consent screen with a list of requested scopes. We assume that the user is logged into the Slack platform, so they can approve the requested permissions in their Slack workspace. When the user clicks Allow, they are redirected to an installation landing page with an authorization code as a query parameter. The idea behind the redirect landing page is to exchange a temporary authorization code for an access token. For this, it calls an API endpoint and passes OAuth code to it. On the backend side, we call Slack API authorization service with this code. The authorization service checks the temporary code and returns an access token with some additional installation information. At this point, the Slack platform adds our custom app to the user's workspace associated with the returned access token. We need to store the access token in the database for long-term use. Now, using the token, we can call Slack Web API methods to obtain information about the user's workspace and act there on behalf of the installed application. Let's see what my code for the redirect landing page looks like. I'm using Angular with ngaccess state management, so some things can be specific for my project and look different for yours. But I won't focus on the framework aspects and only consider the main things related with Slack OAuth flow. The main thing here when the page is opened, I'm taking the temporary auth code from query parameters and passing it to my backend endpoint to exchange it for access token. This is my service class that encapsulates logic related to Slack. For this moment, it has only just add to Slack and remove from Slack method. Here is a HTTP post request for exchange code. Two things only I need for it: the API endpoint pass and temporary auth code as payload. You can see that this method returns void promise. This is because the access token is secret and we plan to store it in the database on the backend side. Thus, the method will not return anything. On the backend, the core token exchange logic is placed in the addToSlack use case class. To interact with the Slack web API, we use the web client instance, which is a part of the Slack web API library. So you need to add the Slack web API package to your dependencies. At this point, we make a request to the Slack API to exchange the code for an access token. The first two parameters are the client ID and the secret key. You can find both on the app's basic information page. I'm keeping them separately in the .env file with other sensitive and environment-dependent variables. The third parameter is the temporary auth code itself. And the last one is the redirect URI that I used before. And this will be enough to successfully obtain an access token. This is what the OAuth access response looks like. Out of all this data, we are interested in three things that I will store in the database. Of course, the access token itself, the ID of the user who provided access to their workspace, the so-called OAuth user ID, and also the bot user ID. A bot is an installed application that can act in workspace as a user, but it is not a real user, so we called it a bot. For this moment, I think only these three things will be useful for me, but basically you can keep all response data just in case. Here we check if we already have an access token for Slack in the database. And if so, we delete it to replace it with a new one, because we don't need to have two tokens for one user. We create a new token at this point and take the result of creation here. It will be an instance of Slack OAuth access class. This class is pretty simple. It consists of a list of getters for every property, static create method, and a private constructor. In the data model, you can find a user ID property that will allow us to associate an access token with a specific user. After creating a Slack OAuth access instance, we store it in the database using the Slack OAuth access wrapper, which I use to communicate with my persistence layer. The Slack OAuth access repo class contains methods for creating, removing, and retrieving a token by user ID. When we need a token to call the Slack web API, we can get it from the database using the get Slack OAuth access method. I'm using the Slack OAuth access model that extends the Mongoose ODM library and the mapper class to convert a Mongoose document to domain object. You can find both classes on my GitHub, but we won't focus on those implementation details since they are very specific to my architecture and may be different for yours. The main thing here is that we store the access token in the database and use it for API calls in the future for the long term. In this video, we looked at the basic process of integrating a web application with the Slack platform. I deliberately did not focus on low-level implementation details and tried to show the main idea of the process. Request permission from the user to install the application, exchange the temporary auth code and save the access token. In next video, I'll show a practical example of using the Slack web API to create channels and send messages. And please don't forget about LSBC pattern. Like, subscribe, bell, comments.